Good morning. We welcome you to our service and so glad that you're here. If you're visiting with us, we're also so appreciative of you being here today. We hope that you feel right at home and that you worship the Lord with us. Before I pray, make mention Eric is not here today. He's traveling for work. Also, Bambi and Tim are away. And so Jake is going to be leading from the piano over here along with Will and Kaya. So let's just join right in and worship with them this morning. Would you join me in prayer? Father, we thank you for your grace. Thank you for your grace that not only saves us, but sustains us day by day. Lord, we pray that your grace would fill our hearts, that your peace that surpasses all understanding would guard our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus, even as we're gathered here in this place. Father, we pray that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart would be acceptable in your sight. Thank you for being so good to us. And we pray that our worship would reflect your goodness to us. We ask these things today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning, everyone. Our first hymn is Be Thou My Vision. It's number 23 in the hymnal. Y'all will stand with us.
Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that Thou
to number 8, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest
seated. This time we'll worship the Lord through our giving. As we think about his faithfulness to us, if our ushers will come, we'll receive our tithes and offerings. Would you pray for the offering, please? Thank you. This is a reading of God's word from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 16 through 21. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people loved the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his work should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Okay, last one this morning, we have Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. It's number 258. Y'all can stay in your seats.
O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to him. Jesus said if I should come to him. No one else can be my strength. I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful. He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to him. No can be my shield, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said, if I am lost, he will come to me. And he showed me on the cross, he will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus strong and kind.
The youth movement stops with me, I guess. We want to have a special time of prayer next Saturday, if my memory serves me right, is when Jamie and Jake Gates are going to be leaving for the Ivory Coast in West Africa to do medical missions work. And so part of their goal in the mission group that they're going to be going with is to offer hope through healing, through performing surgeries. It's going to be very demanding work. Jamie has gone several times over the years. But also their ultimate hope is to bring hope through the gospel witness there in the Ivory Coast. And so as they're leaving this Saturday, we wanted to have a special time of prayer for them, and I want to encourage all of you to keep them in your prayers as they leave in just over a little under a week. And so what I'd like to do is to ask Jamie and Jake to come and kneel in the altar up here, and if their family would like to come and is able to, if you'd like to gather around them and lay hands on them, I'd also like to ask all the ordained deacons and pastors to come and lay hands on them. And I've asked Brother Forrest if he would come to the podium and lead us in a time of prayer for Jamie and Jake. So Jamie and Jake, would y'all come and kneel, please, and those that would like to can gather around them, and Brother Forrest will lead us.
Shall we pray? Lord, we rejoice today at the thought that those from among us will be sharing your good news and will also extend a healing hand in the dark continent of Africa. I pray, dear Lord, that you would be with every member of the team. We thank you for those who have planned it and arranged it. We thank you for the healing ministry that was carried on in that general area for so long by our dear servant, Dr. Miley and his wife. And now they're with you, but there are others who have stepped in and who are reaching out with the good news and healing. Dear Lord, I pray that you will keep your hand upon each of them, that you will protect them, that you will provide for them. And I pray, Lord, most of all, that you will anoint them and bless them, that the work of their hands and the words of their mouth will be such that you will be glorified, that people will be greatly helped. We thank you, Lord, for these men and for their love for you, for their willingness to go, to take time, to be able to spend this time in this healing effort. We pray for their families, who no doubt will be of special concern during this time. We pray you'll be with them, bless them in their labor, and restore them to us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Again, encourage you to keep them in your prayers, and their family in your prayers as well. We'll be looking forward to hearing from them eventually when they get back, and what the Lord did while they were away. I invite you to turn your Bible, if you'd like to follow along, to the book of Jonah. We'll be in Jonah chapter 4. If by chance somebody's visiting with us for the first time or for the first time in a while, we've been working our way through the book of Jonah, and we're to the end here in chapter 4 this morning. Jonah chapter 4, verse 1 says, "But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Do you do well to be angry?" Jonah went out of the city and sat to the east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade till he should see what would become of the city. Now the Lord God appointed a plant and made it come up over Jonah that it might be a shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun arose, God appointed a scorching east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint. And he asked that he might die and said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Do you do well to be angry for the plant?" And he said, "Yes, I do well to be angry, angry enough to die." And the Lord said, "You pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle?" This is the word of the Lord. If you have experienced the grace of God, how could you possibly withhold it from someone else? You ever think about that? If you've experienced the grace of God, let me put it another way. If you've been saved, if you're a Christian, and yet you know there's someone else that actually needs grace, we're saved by God's mercy, we don't do anything to deserve it, and yet you know someone else, you've experienced that, and there's someone else that hasn't, is there any possible way you could find it within your heart to withhold grace from them? In other words, do you think that there are people out there that actually don't deserve the grace of God? So what's puzzling as we reach the end of the book of Jonah, Jonah, the prophet of God, actually has that as his heart condition. Jonah, as we've seen, is the running prophet in chapter 1. He heard the call from God to
go and preach against that great city of Nineveh, and yet instead of doing that, he runs in the opposite direction. Perhaps for a moment or two, he's the drowning prophet as he's thrown overboard, and then he becomes quickly the praying prophet in chapter 2 inside the belly of the great fish. He begins to pray and actually even exclaims in his prayer, "Salvation belongs to the Lord," and the fish, at the appointment of God, vomited Jonah out on dry land. And then in chapter 3, he becomes the preaching prophet, which is what he should have done all along anyway. But here in chapter 4, we might picture Jonah as the pouting prophet. The pouting prophet. Or, more accurately, he's the angry prophet. That, if you were to capture one word, or let's say you put it in an emoji, is that what they're called? An emoji? I got in trouble a few weeks ago, maybe last year sometime or 2 years ago. I didn't get in trouble, but it made quite the rounds when I impersonated Yosemite Sam up here. I've had some preacher friends that heard that and watched that, and it never let me live it down. So I'm not about to do that again. But that kind of captures inside what's going on in the prophet Jonah. It's very strange. It's almost humorous. There's a thread of humor that's spreading throughout the book of Jonah, and it's clear here. I mean, this guy should be exceedingly happy, because at the end of last week's chapter, we saw that he preached, and an entire city does what? An entire city repents. So scores of people have turned away from their evil. He has preached in 40 days, Nineveh is going to be overthrown, and the people, it says in chapter 3, believed God. That's the goal of every preacher. And yet, instead of being happy about that, he's exceedingly angry. Matthew Henry, the great commentator, said this: "What strange sort of man was Jonah to dread the success of his ministry?" Remember, though, what we've said throughout this book is that sometimes as we look at Jonah, we can actually see a little bit of ourselves in Jonah. And what I get from chapter 4 largely is this: that you can actually believe God, you can be obedient to God as he is in chapter 3, and yet sometimes you still need your heart to be changed. To put it in our context, you can be a Christian and have justification, a right standing with God, and yet at times throughout your life as a believer, you can reach a place where your heart isn't right. You can be obeying and going through the motions and going to church and being faithful in many different ways, and yet sometimes you can have a heart condition where you actually need for God to do a major heart renovation, a heart change. And that's what was true here of Jonah, the prophet of God. There are some things in the text that show us that Jonah, who believed God, Jonah the prophet of God, his heart wasn't right with God. There are some things in this passage that show us that I want to draw out this morning and point you in this direction. So the three things that we're going to talk about this morning that demonstrate that Jonah's heart wasn't right with God are what I want to call, first of all, sinful justification. The second thing we'll consider this morning that shows Jonah's heart wasn't right with God is God's loving correction. And then the final thing we'll consider this morning was God's leading question. So sinful justification, loving correction, and a leading question. And so first, let me explain to you what I mean by sinful justification. Five times in Jonah chapter 4, five times it's emphasized that Jonah is angry. Angry enough, he says, to die. We encounter people along the way, perhaps we've been there ourselves, where we are saddened enough to die. Oftentimes that's tied with depression. You can be so down and so sad that you can almost wish to die. But here, Jonah is angry. Angry, he says, enough to die. He was angry because God, according to his own testimony, God had relented from the disaster that he had warned he was going to bring on Nineveh and its people. Remember, that was the central theme of Jonah's message in chapter 3. Yet 40 days and Nineveh is going to be overthrown. It implied, though, in the preaching of Jonah was this conditional promise. All along it stood that if the people repented of Nineveh, if they turned away from their evil ways, then God was not going to send the disaster. He would not overthrow the city. But make no mistake about it, if the people did not repent, then the overthrow of the city was absolutely certain. And yet Jonah tells us here, in fact, he tells God, look, I knew this all along. I knew this was going to happen. He argues with God, if you notice chapter 4 and verse 2, he says, I knew this about you. You're a gracious God and merciful and slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. He's actually quoting from Exodus chapter 34. I knew this about you all along. You see, Jonah had insider knowledge about God. He knew this was going to happen, and that's what made him so angry. And yet, all throughout chapter 4, Jonah is saying, in essence, you know what? I am right to be angry. I'm right to be angry. This is when we reach the place in our lives as believers, as Jonah was here, where we're actually in the wrong, but we go out of our way to justify when we're in the wrong. That's what I mean by sinful justification. Jonah's anger here is clearly sinful, and yet he thinks all the time, you know what, I'm absolutely right. I'm justified in being angry, even angry at you, God. You know, the tricky thing is about our hearts, at least I can speak from my own experience, is, you really got to watch your heart, don't you? You got to pay close attention to what you're actually saying and doing, because when your heart isn't right with God, you can begin to justify words that you shouldn't say. When your heart's not right with God, you can begin to justify attitudes that you have towards certain people. You can begin to think all the time to deceive yourself, you know what, I'm in the right. I'm justified for harboring this resentment. I'm justified for whatever the case might be. When we do it all the time, that's the way the human heart works. Because of our fallen nature, because of our hearts being depraved, the Bible says our hearts are desperately wicked. And so we find ways, even when we're clearly in the wrong, we find ways to justify our behavior, our actions, our attitudes. Think of a couple of other examples. We're thinking here about Jonah's anger, this inner rage that he has, and he's justifying it. We could do it in other ways. Think, for example, about adultery. You know, a person might reason to himself or herself, well, you know what, after all these years I've been investing my time, my energy, my resources into our marriage, my spouse hasn't been investing himself or herself the way I do, and they don't show me the attention that I deserve or demand, and so you know what, I'm justified in this relationship. It happens all the time. Even though internally from the outset you know that it's wrong because you're made in the image and likeness of God, and God has written his law on the human conscience, on the human heart, and yet you find a way to justify that behavior. Or it could be something like greed. Things related to money. I'm just pulling a couple of examples, you know. I hate to tell all of us, but it's going to be tax season soon. And the person might reason to himself, you know what, the government takes all our money. Thought I would get an amen on that one, but the government takes away all our money, and everyone gets away with so much anyway, and I work so hard, I barely can make ends meet. You know what, I'm justified in fudging just a little bit on these taxes. We do it all the time. What I mean by sinful justification, when our actions, our words, or in Jonah's case, our inner attitude, our inner spirit isn't right, but you know what? We say to ourselves, you know what? I'm right in being this way. We're not. Anger, lest anyone misunderstand me, anger is a human emotion that has its proper place. Jesus, we know this, Jesus was angry, and yet he didn't sin. But because of the fall, we have sometimes anger that's out of place or anger that's directed at the wrong object or person, and internally we can try to justify sinful anger and bitterness. That's where Jonah was. We got this built-in mechanism to defend ourselves. You know, a few years ago, my in-laws, Amanda's parents, were driving. They actually had one of the grandbabies in the vehicle with them, and they were driving down the road, and they were hit by a drunk driver. And they messed their vehicle up, and it also injured both of them. Thankfully, the baby was just fine. But it's astonishing. It's been years now, and they still haven't received a settlement. They weren't out for, this is a side note, they weren't out for a settlement for anything other than to cover all their medical expenses, but they're still waiting on that. And, of course, you can imagine someone in that situation, you have to go out and hire a lawyer. right? You have to have someone to stand up in court and defend and advocate for you in those kind of situations. But have you ever noticed that when it comes to our own actions and attitudes and what I'm talking about this morning, we don't have to hire any lawyer on the inside when we're in the wrong spiritually. We have this built-in mechanism inside ourselves that comes to our defense immediately, you see. I'm right. Jonah says, I am right to be angry. He wasn't. The second thing that points out that Jonah's heart wasn't in the right place was what I'm calling loving correction. So Jonah is wrong, but he's trying to justify it. But God patiently and tenderly keeps on trying to lovingly correct the prophet. You know, when you think about it, Jonah is a key figure, obviously, throughout the book. He is central as the book closes here in chapter 4, but Jonah is not the main character in the book. See, God is the main character not only all throughout the Bible, but here in Jonah as well. You see, God's character, his disposition toward people is on full display throughout the book of Jonah, and also it's on full display in how he interacts with Jonah the prophet. The final verse of Jonah, which we'll come to in a moment, displays the heart and character of God for all people. But don't miss it here. Don't miss the fact that God keeps on patiently and tenderly and persistently interacting, trying to correct the prophet Jonah. Many people have pointed out down through the years that Jonah is much like one of the brothers in the parable that Jesus told in Luke chapter 15. Do you remember the parable? The parable of the prodigal son? We name it the parable of the prodigal son because perhaps the prodigal is the one that gets the most space in the parable. Maybe many of us identify with the prodigal. He went away from his father and wasted his inheritance with riotous living. He reached the end of his rope, you know, and he came to himself and he said, you know what, I'm going to go back to my father's house. And on his way back, his father has been waiting for him the whole time, and the father runs and embraces him and throws the party, basically. You remember that? But remember, the elder brother in the story that Jesus told, the other elder brother out in the field, he always kept his nose clean. He had never left his father. He had not wasted his inheritance. He had always, quote, done right by his father. And now, when the younger brother came home and they're throwing a party and everything, the elder brother's out in the field, and he refuses to go in and join the party. Why is he so upset? He's so upset because the father is treating the one who squandered everything this way with mercy and with grace. And the elder brother says, you know what? I'm not going to rejoice at all. This is where Jonah is here in Jonah chapter 4, isn't it? The one who's, quote, kept his nose clean. The one who, to put it in our context, has gone to church his whole life. The one who's kept the commands of God, the one who's the elder brother, who cannot fathom in his mind why and how did God give mercy and grace to all those Ninevites. They didn't deserve it. And God comes to him and says, do you do well to be angry? I don't mean that God speaks in an audible voice, but can I put it this way? Has God ever come to you in whatever condition your heart is in and said to you, Do you do well to be angry? Is your heart right? You know, what you've got going on inside of you right now, are you right in this? Remember, Jonah has exclaimed in chapter 2 in his prayer, he said, salvation belongs to the Lord. We would think that Jonah's heart has been changed at the core of his being in chapter 2, but here he is in chapter 4, and God is patiently and persistently coming to him and saying, listen, your heart isn't right. Started to say, dude, your heart isn't right, man. Let me correct it. He needs open heart surgery again. This is kind of neither here nor there, but did you realize that the first open heart surgery in America was performed in 1893? It's a fun fact. You can talk about that over lunch today if you have, trivia night or something. 1893. I didn't realize it went that far back in America. In 1893, a young Chicagoan named James Cornish was stabbed in the chest, and the hospital he went to had a surgeon named Daniel Hale Williams, who gathered six other doctors to observe while he operated, and with primitive or crude anesthesia, he began the surgery. And sometime later, after he sewed him up, 51 days after this, James Cornish walked out of the hospital, and he lived 20 years after the surgery. Wow, that's what I said. Thank you. I had a heart surgery on July 26, 1989, when I first came to faith in Christ, and he gave me new life. He forgave me of all of my sins, and he gave me a fresh and a new start. He performed literally a spiritual heart surgery on me, but can I tell you this morning, I've needed a heart surgery many times since. That's the message of the book of Jonah, this man that had received the grace and mercy of God in chapter 2 that says salvation belongs to the Lord. Here he is in chapter 4 needing to learn this all over again. It's true, isn't it? God appoints a plant. It says in chapter 4, verse 4, do you do well to be angry? Verse 5, Jonah went out of the city and sat at the east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat it under the shade till he should see what should become of the city. Don't know why he did that. Perhaps he's still waiting the 40 days. Did he have a hope that God might change his mind again and bring disaster, that the repentance wasn't real? We don't know, but he's sitting there seeing what's going to happen to the city. And the Lord appointed a plant. Don't, again, miss God's sovereignty throughout the book of Jonah. God's sovereignty is demonstrated time and time again. He appointed the fish. In chapter 1, he here appoints the plant to shade Jonah, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God appointed a scorching east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that it was faint. And he asked that he might die and said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, same question, do you do well to be angry for the plant? Yeah, I'm angry enough to die. I'm right. The preacher Tim Keller, who passed away this past year, says about this, about Jonah here, that God rebukes Jonah for preaching to the city without loving the city. He rebukes Jonah for preaching to the city without actually loving the city. Because God says, as he's trying to correct him, God says to him, look, you pity the plant. You didn't labor for it. It grew up overnight. It's going to perish in a night. He's saying, look, Jonah, as a prophet of God, as a person that believes in God, you actually pity the plant more than you do people. You value and treasure your own comfort more than the conversion of an entire city. See, Jonah obeyed the Lord in chapter 3, but I submit to you, he preached, he obeyed without the right kind of heart. And it's possible for all of us to do that. That leads me, finally, to what I want to call a leading question. So sinful justification, Jonah's heart wasn't right. We see that he's trying to justify all the time. I'm in the right. Secondly, is loving correction on the part of God. He patiently and tenderly keeps on working in Jonah's life, if Jonah will respond. The final thing is this leading question. That's the last verse. God reasons, look, Jonah, you pity the plant. Verse 11, should not I pity Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle. This is, as far as I can tell, the only book in the Bible that ends with a question. And it's a question with an obvious answer. Some suggest that the reference to 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left is pointing out the people who drive in Nashville. I'm not kidding. That's not the case. But that just came to my mind. Some people suggest this is pointing out the number of children within the city. This is an example of a possibility. People, let's say, under the age of accountability, don't know their right. They're still being formed. They don't know their right from their left. Others propose is simply a rough estimate of the total population of Nineveh, which would include adults. And if this is the case, it further displays the heart of compassion God has for the city. After all, in one sense, these people knew full well what they were doing. Right? These people, as we saw from the beginning of Jonah chapter 1, these people were full of idolatry. Their hands were full of bloodshed and violence. That's what they were known for. And so they knew full well what they were doing, and they were accountable for it. God was going to call them to account for it. And yet, even though they're responsible and know what they're doing, there's another sense in which they don't know what they're doing. What Jesus said about the people that put him on the cross as he prayed, "Father, forgive them." Why? They do not know what they're doing. These people in Nineveh are dazed and confused. They don't know their way forward. But after all, at the bottom of it all, these are people made in the image and likeness of God. Every person, let me remind all of us here this morning, that every person has worth in the eyes of God. Every person has a soul. Every person is worth saving and saving from the destructive nature of sin. Sin is not simply the transgression. It is the transgression of God's law, but when we transgress God's law, it does all kinds of things to us. It leads us down a destructive path, and it blinds us to so many things, and that's where these people were. They don't know their right from their left. God says, should I not have compassion on this whole city? It reminds me of what we see in the Gospels of Jesus as he no doubt spoke to Jerusalem about what was coming in AD 70. He prophesied and told them that destruction was coming, and yet as he looked out over an entire city, it said of him there that when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it. He saw the city and he wept over it. Judgment was coming, but judgment was coming to a city that was full of people that would reject him, people that were responsible for crucifying him, that would be accountable for it, and yet it doesn't negate the fact that Jesus weeps for the city. He longs for those people to know him and to prove his love for them and for us. He goes to the cross to die for them. As we fast forward away from Nineveh and we think about our own backyard, this idea of people that don't know their right from their left. You know, recent numbers show that Cheatham County has over 40,000 people. I think if I looked right, it's about 42,000, give or take. And that number, as we all know, is increasing. We can tell that by the number of houses and traffic and so forth. And as you think about our own neck of the woods, this isn't an unreached people group. Think about Jamie and Jake going on a mission trip this coming week. We think about the Colwells being in Japan, and think about Cody and Tori helping plant a church in Oklahoma, and the missionaries that we send across the world. In mission terms, an unreached people group is a people group that doesn't have a gospel witness among them. That there are people groups in the world that don't have access to the Bible. They've never heard the gospel. There's not a substantial gospel witness among them. And so when we think about our own backyard, these 40-plus thousand people that are here in Cheatham County, they're not an unreached people group because there are churches everywhere. There are many Bible-believing churches in our area faithful to the Lord, and we ought to be thankful for this. However, even though this is not an unreached people group in that sense, I submit to you there are many in our own backyard that don't know their right hand from their left hand. They are confused and harassed and struggling, but they're made in the image and likeness of God. One of the most beautiful verses in all of the Bible says that Jesus tasted death for every man. Did you know that? That Jesus tasted death for every man. For every man. For every man, woman, young boy, young girl. No matter who they are, no matter where they live, no matter what they have done, Jesus, demonstrating his own love for us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. To bring us out of our confusion, to bring us out of the place where we don't know our right from our left, morally speaking. Yes, we're called to reach the nations, and I hope, again, you'll pray for Jamie and Jake as they go this week, and we'll pray for the Colwells and all these efforts. Well, let's not forget we have to reach our own Jerusalem. Our church must value people over possessions. Our church must value conversions over our own comfort. We must make sure as a church that the marching orders of Jesus remain firmly in our hearts, and that is to make disciples of all the nations, make disciples of all peoples. Again, we're living in a time when people are dazed and confused. They're consumed by the consequences of their own sin, choices no doubt of their own, and yet confused and harassed ultimately by the evil one. And what these people need is not our moral superiority. Don't misunderstand me. They need to see holiness in us as Christians. They do need to see that we do have morals, that we're living by them. God's called us to a standard, but they don't need to see us in terms of living in such a way that suggests we're holier than you are. We don't need to look down our noses at the people around us that are dazed and confused, that don't know their right from their left hand, but instead to reach out with a helping and healing hand. See, if we're really growing in holiness, it's going to be demonstrated in our tender compassion and love. Jonah's problem, you see, was largely about the Ninevites. It was those kind of people, you see. Those kind of people don't deserve the grace and mercy of God. That was Jonah's problem. But if we want our hearts to be right with God, we've got to rid ourselves of that mentality. We've got to root out prejudice and racism and pride and ask God to give us a clean heart. The book of Jonah is a book about Jonah, but as I've said, it's more importantly about God. God is the God of second chances, a God who pursues both a rebellious prophet and a wicked city full of people who didn't follow or worship him. And it ends, this book ends with this puzzling picture of a man who had been delivered from the depths, but he still needed his heart to be changed. The preacher that led me to the Lord preached for decades. He used to always, I couldn't tell you how many times he would end the sermon and he would say, "How is it with you this morning?" You've been thinking about Jonah, the prophet, and his heart. Maybe the issue for you is not anger. It could be anything else internally, and you've been justifying it. And God patiently, lovingly, persistently keeps coming to you through people, through sermons, through whatever circumstances, and he's lovingly trying to correct your heart, saying, in essence, "Let me do open heart surgery on you." You've been thinking about Jonah's heart. How's your heart this morning? How is it with you? If you find this morning that your heart isn't in the right place, you're a Christian, you believe in God, maybe even you've been obeying God, but you know deep down your heart isn't in the right place. Can I tell you this morning what you need to do is to pray what David prayed in Psalm 51, "Lord, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." If you do that, he'll listen, he'll do it. Let's pray. Father, so many times throughout our walk in this life, we have to pray that prayer. Father, I get so tired of praying it because my heart is so desperately wicked. I'll be glad of the day when I'm finally set free from any struggle with sin. Lord, but until that day, we keep on needing fresh touches of your grace. Thank you that your word tells us that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we come to you now in these moments claiming that promise. And Father, if there's someone here that needs to pray that prayer afresh and anew, I pray they would do that in their hearts. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand as we have an invitational song?
It's 169.
As we sing together, if you need to come forward and pray that kind of prayer that God would create in you a clean heart, please do that as we sing.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. And the cross, be
second verse.
The river near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its scenes before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadows o'er me. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river.
You can be seated, please. I got to ask a question, Brother Barry. Brother Barry. Are we going to have a baptism? Okay, we're going to have a baptism. They're on their way. While they're coming, I'm going to give you a whole list of announcements, so please bear with me as they come and make preparation. This evening at 5:30, we will observe the Lord's Supper and the washing of the saints' feet. This occurs four times a year, normally among us, and we invite everyone to come at 5:30. There's a new ladies' Bible study. Ladies, please be sure to consider coming on Wednesday evening for that. Barry mentioned that tax season is upon us. Brother Barney has prepared tax forms for you related to your giving to the church in the past year. They're on the table out in the vestibule. Please pick yours up today. We also, on the table out in the vestibule, we have a list for the funeral meal chain. If you're willing to help provide food when it's needed, when we have funerals, and you would like to be called and asked to bring something, please sign that list. Now, I know many of you work and so on, but the ladies who do this generally make a plan where you can drop off your food here at the church, so you don't necessarily have to be here personally. If you'd like to participate, please sign the funeral meal chain list. There's also a sign up for Bethel Alerts. We have a robocall that goes out in times of emergency, like the snow that we had when we canceled church. And if you'll put your name and contact information on that list, you'll get that call in the future whenever we need to communicate with all of our people by that means. We have three young people who are planning to go on E-Team. That's the missionary trip that is offered in the summertime. Michelle Gupton, Chloe Stavanis, and Elliot Lytle. And my understanding is that a meal is being planned next Sunday evening. If you would like to come and hear their plans for going, and if you would like to assist them, you'll have opportunity to do that. Do you have a time in mind? 5:00? Don't be late. Don't be late. You know how free wills are. They'll eat it up from you. But I hope many of you will come and support them, both in your presence and prayers, and if you are able to help them in their financial needs. I'm hoping that we may be able to hear something more from them personally, perhaps next week. We also want to make note that Eddie and Betsy Bowman are going to be celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary, and it says their 80th birthdays. on February 10th. It's a testimony to the grace of God and to the patience of Miss Betsy that this will occur. So you'll be hearing more about that in the future. We're so grateful that in last Wednesday evening's service, a young person gave their heart to the Lord Jesus. He's still at work. All I can say is glory to God. Amen. Thank you so much. Let's pray together. Thank you, dear Lord, for what you are doing and what you're about to do. We ask, dear Lord, that you would simply help us to prepare our hearts. And I pray, dear Lord, especially for these who have so recently come to know you. Strengthen them and help them, I pray. Go with us now. To our homes, we pray in Jesus' name.